Okay, please remain standing for the sermon. When we were living in Austin, Texas, it was the day after Thanksgiving and my parents were visiting, and I thought, oh, it'd be neat to take my dad to a college football game. So we went to see University of Texas and Texas A&M. Well, we were living in Austin, so we were rooting for University of Texas. Unfortunately, I got the seats in the A&M section. Is anybody an A&M fan? Okay. You know, they stand during the whole game. My dad was not very happy. We had to stand during the whole game to be able to see it, because that's something, a tradition for A&M fans, is they don't sit down, they stand during the whole game. Only in Texas, right?
Oops. A lot of crazy people down there.
All right. What are we talking about today? Again, today we're talking about God knows what we need, and hopefully this shouldn't have a question mark at the end of it, but it's a declaration that you know that God really does know what you need. And so we're going to be looking at the scripture from Acts chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer, at 3 in the afternoon. Now, a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those who were going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us!" So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I do I have to give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Let us pray, Lord. We are thankful for your scripture and your word today. We pray that it reveals the truth to us. Open our hearts and our minds to receive what you have for us today. And help me to be your messenger in Jesus' name. Amen. This reminds me of another scripture in Matthew chapter 9, verse 2, that some men brought to Jesus, to him, a paralyzed man lying on a mat. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the man, "Take heart, son, your sins are forgiven." Is that why they brought that man in front of them? No, they brought that man because he wanted to be healed. But Jesus knew what he actually needed, right? He needed to be forgiven first before he was healed. Do you ever ask for the wrong thing?
Yeah.
Sometimes ignorance, sometimes we're blinded, sometimes we just don't know. I've met with people that when I've met with them, what they wanted was money, but what they needed was healing. Okay? And sometimes that's the way with us. Sometimes we think what we need is money. But what we really need is some kind of spiritual healing possibly to take place first, or physical healing to take place first. Maybe if we got the money, God knows that we would not be responsible with it if we didn't have the healing first, and we didn't know, we couldn't hang on to money, we didn't manage it well, we didn't budget, we couldn't, you know, we would just blow it on something. And then again, next week we were going before the Lord asking for more money. Sometimes we don't always know what we need. We pray for what we want, but we may not actually know what we need. But God knows what we need. And sometimes you got to search God to pray for the right thing. Sometimes you just need to sit and ask God, God, I'm in this, you know, the situation I'm in. I'm not sure how to pray or what to pray for. I need money or I need provision. You know, blessings, sometimes we get locked up into blessing is only money. But God blesses us in many ways. And sometimes it's provision to meet a financial need, but it may not be actually money that he gives us. It may be in another way. So we have to be careful we don't put God in a box. The lame man, he's there banging at the gate. Because why? Because he knows at the prayer time when the Jews come, part of who they are is to help the poor. That's part of what they're supposed to do. That's part of what God said to do, is to help the poor. And so he knows he's probably going to get some money if he's outside the gate asking for money. But Peter doesn't give money. What's he say? Gold and silver I do not have. What I have, I'll give you. Okay? Well, the Holy Spirit's working in Peter. Peter's being led by the Spirit on what he's supposed to do. He's supposed to heal this man, not give him money. What do you think would make the man happier? Did he get a few coins or that he's healed? Well, the way he was jumping and rejoicing and praising God, I think it was because of the healing. Sometimes we underestimate God. Sometimes we ask for something that we think is immediate and it's easy to get. Maybe we don't have enough faith to ask for bigger things. Maybe we don't trust God enough. But God wants more than just to give us money. God wants us to have a new life in Him. He wants to make us whole, whether it's physical or spiritual. He doesn't want to just give us money. You know, God operates in a different realm than we operate in. He gives us what we need. We may not even recognize that's what we need, but He gives us. Just like that other story where the paralyzed man was brought before Jesus expecting to be healed, but what? Jesus said, your sins are forgiven. And then healed. You know, this, as we go through the book of Acts, we'll see right now the believers are still going to the temple, okay? But as we get later in the book of Acts, there's resentment between the Jews that are Christ believers and the Jews that are not. And they also realize when Stephen comes in that they have the Holy Spirit and they actually don't have to go to the temple anymore to pray. And so they stop. But at this time, they're still going to the temple. And these are the prayer times that they go. 9 o'clock, noon, and 3 p.m, 3 times a day to pray. This man was crippled from birth. And I'm not sure exactly why he set up outside this particular gate called Beautiful. I think there was 9 different gates and entrances in the temple. But this is the one that he chose to set outside. Peter and John, we're starting to see a theme. If you haven't noticed, they're often together, right? Well, they fished together, right? They prepared the last Passover together. They ran to the tomb on Easter morning together. And they go and preach to the Samaritans together. So we see this a lot, but if you start looking through Scripture more, you see often the two were paired, okay? That was part of God's plan that you go out in twos when you go out and minister. You know, the other one has your back or whatever, but I don't know all the reasons, but there's safety in numbers, maybe. There's a protection, plus they were happened to be together, and other disciples went together in pairs. We see this with the Mormons, and we saw it all the time in Taiwan. They always go out in twos together. What's that mean? He deflected the glory. He didn't take it unto himself. And if you remember, it wasn't that long ago, the disciples were arguing who was the greatest, right? But he says, this is done in the name of Jesus. Have you ever prayed for somebody for healing or something, or to get a job or whatever it might be, and then they got it, and you took credit instead of giving God the glory? All of a sudden, Peter's now a humble servant of the Lord. No longer does he have that pride about who's going to be the greatest. Now he's serving God. And the resurrection and the Holy Spirit coming on these disciples just totally transformed them. From frightened men hiding behind locked doors, they're out now boldly and courageously proclaiming the message of the Lord Jesus Christ. But here's the big thing. They'd be totally ineffective without God's power. You know, that's, if you go, you know, you should be praying every morning, not only for God to give you the opportunities to witness, but the power that the Holy Spirit, pray for that fresh feeling of the Holy Spirit to come upon you and give you that power to keep you in touch with God. We talk about the power of the Holy Spirit, but how can you stay in touch with God and to know His will and to have His power if you don't have a relationship with God? If you don't know what His voice is, if you don't know what His prompting is, it's very difficult to know how He is leading you and how He is guiding you. That's why we continue to talk about how important that relationship is. And not take it for granted, but each and every day to spend time in His Word. Spend time in prayer. Spend time in dialogue with God. And don't just give your laundry list of items of prayer, but spend time listening. What He wants to tell you. What He wants to reveal to you each and every day. Economic poverty or spiritual poverty. They're both poverty, aren't they not? That's hard to say. Both poverty, yeah. Are they not? What makes a church rich? What makes your lives rich? Is it economics or is it spiritual? And even, we can talk even about this church. What makes this church rich? It's not by the money, that's for sure, that's taken in. Hopefully that we are a church that is moving into being dependent on God. And we are dependent on God. We're even the financial, we're dependent on God, that He will use you to meet the financial needs of this church and this operation. I want to show you something. I thought this was really interesting. This is a quote by Thomas, and I'm not sure how to say his last name, Aquinas. He lived in 1200s, okay? And he was a theologian, well-known theologian of the time. And he has this conversation with the Pope, and it goes like this. He called on Pope Innocent II when the latter was counting out a large sum of money. The Pope remarked, "You see, Thomas, the church can no longer say, 'Silver and gold have I none.'" Aquinas replied, "Truly, Holy Father, but neither can she now say, 'Rise and walk.'" Uh-oh. Rise and walk. It's kind of a sad commentary, isn't it? Churches are all concerned that they're going to have enough finances to make their budget and to pay their bills. That should not be the focus of the church. The focus of the church should be rise and walk. The focus of the church should be that you're growing spiritually. You know, we had hoped by now we'd have more numbers in this church, but our focus is on the ones that do come. Our focus is that you are growing in the Lord, spiritually growing in the Lord. Your faith is growing. Your trust is growing. It reminds me of a story about a pastor who had an affluent church. And he was meeting with another pastor from a small church that was just making their bills. And the pastor of the affluent church told the other pastor, he says, "I envy you." He said, "Why do you envy us? We're just barely making our budget each and every week." He says, "Because you are dependent on God to meet your needs." He said, "We aren't. You know, if we have something come up, needs to be paid for, we just pay for it. Nobody seeks the Lord on it because we've got the finances already there." He said, "But you have to pray and you have to seek the Lord each and every time that you need to meet a need." Salvation. This paralyzed man, he was born lame, just like us. Just like us. Unable to walk, just like us. Or to please God. Poor. We come before the Lord also poor, spiritually. We're bankrupt, right? We can't pay the debt. Only Jesus could pay the debt on the cross. He can't pay for our salvation. There's no money that we could possibly earn to pay for our salvation. But Jesus did it for us on the cross. We're outside the temple. Without Jesus, we wouldn't have any access to God, the Father. As sinners, sin separates us from God. We cannot be in God's presence because of sin. Only through what Jesus did, by the grace of God, can we be in His presence. And now, just as that man was able to stand and walk, just as quickly as that happened, it can happen. It happens to us. As soon as we're willing to accept Jesus in our lives and confess Him as our Lord and Savior, we receive immediate healing. We receive immediate restoration and reconciliation unto God, the Father. And this is what we should be doing. We should be leaping and we should be praising God for what He did for us. We are no longer on the outside. We are on the inside.
Amen.
Because of what Jesus did on the cross for us.
Thank you, God. Thank you.
Praise God. Never take it for granted. But here's where we often go. We put God in a box. You know, we have a hard time. If it doesn't seem logical to us, then God can't do it. You know, and I kind of think of it this way. We have finite brains and finite minds. God is infinite. God can do anything in the universe, outside the universe, in creation, outside. He can do anything. But too often we give up. When we were first in Taiwan and we were meeting with Taiwanese pastors, I remember one pastor saying, you know, God can't do it. And he didn't say those words, but he said, "Well, I can't get anybody to come to the church or whatever." And we're saying, "Did you just say God can't do it?" And he kind of like, you know, choked on his words. He said, "Well, that's not what I meant." I said, "That's what you said." But sometimes we just think, because we can't imagine it being done, that God can't. We limit His power. The man that was begging for money never ever thought somebody was actually going to heal him. "Just give me some money so I can get by for the day." That's all he was looking for. Do we have enough faith? God's testing us all the time. We were talking this morning in the Bible study about the talents. And God invests in us. How do we respond? God tests us with the little things before he gives us the big things. And I use an example when my children were become 16 and want to drive the car, and they want me to hand the keys over the car to them. I said, no, you're not responsible. And they said, what do you mean we're not responsible? We can drive, okay. I said, because you don't do your chores, because you don't keep your room up, because I cannot trust you with the little things, why would I trust you with the big things and the responsibility behind the wheel when you showed me you can't be trustworthy? God does the same thing. He's our Father. Mm-hmm. He's testing you and trusting you with the little things all the time. Will you give that man on the corner a bottle of water? Will you do this? Will you do that? And you don't think it's a big deal. And you may ignore the prompting of the Holy Spirit, not realizing you're being tested. He's not going to give you the bigger things unless you're faithful in the small things. Does that make sense? Sometimes we don't realize that. We want the big things. God says, you haven't been faithful with the small things. Matthew 17, verse 20 says, Jesus replied, because you have so little faith, truly I tell you, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. Well, mustard seed, I mean, it's just a tiny, tiny little seed. And he's saying, you don't even have that much faith. When we pray for healing for people, it's dependent on our faith. Are we just praying because we know we're supposed to pray because we're Christians? Or are we praying, we're actually believing that God will heal this person? Whatever the infirmity may be. Whether it's physical, whether it's spiritual, whether it's relationships, whatever it may be. We pray with faith, and God heals with the amount of faith that we have.
Yeah.
Do you think God could have something better for your life than what you imagined? Mm-hmm. If so, why do we not trust in Him? Mm-hmm. Why do we continue to rely on ourselves? The man's asking for money, and Peter heals him so he can walk again and make money. It's part of faith, it's part of trust, trusting in God that He does have something better for us than what we can imagine. You know, we call it a sacrifice when we turn our lives over to Christ. Is it really a sacrifice? It actually turns out to be a blessing. Because God wants something so much better for us than what we could possibly imagine. It's not a life of suffering, but a life of abundance. As we see in John chapter 10, all who ever came before me are thieves and robbers, Jesus said. But the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved. And will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal, kill, and to destroy. I have come that they may have life. And what kind of life? Abundant life. So when you are condemning yourself, that's not from God. It's from the enemy. Mm-hmm. When we are deceived, when we believe lies about ourselves or about others, that's not from God. That's from the enemy. And if you ever question if it's from God, ask Him. God, is this from you? He'll respond. You can when you have that relationship with Him. God came, or God wants us to have that life abundantly. That's what He wants for us. It's the enemy that wants to destroy us. Oh God. wants to deceive us. Does everyone believe that God answers our prayer?
Yes.
It may not be the answer we want. It may be no. It may be wait. It may be immediate. Okay. But God answers our prayers. But we also have to believe when we pray that God knows what we need. And sometimes we've got to seek Him. Ow! To pray for the things that God wants or knows that we need and not the things that we want. And that's, again, it goes back to being able to have that relationship with God, that daily dialogue with God, and so that you know His prompt and you know His leading because you're in relationship with Him. Has God always given you what you thought you needed or you asked for? Mm-hmm. Oftentimes He gives us something else, right? Mm-hmm. When we were in Taiwan, after 3 years there, God told me that He was going to make me into a pastor, and I argued with Him. I said, no, I don't want to be a pastor. Mm-hmm. And God said, no, that's my plan for you. And I continued praying about it, and of course, so I followed his plan, and that's how I ended up here today. And I'll tell you, as a result of being here, I've been blessed. I live in a life that is the most fulfilling that I've ever lived in my life because God knew what I needed, and I didn't. I was short-sighted. He was far-sighted. He knows the big plan. All we know is what's right in front of us. And so sometimes, you know, people call it a blind leap. I don't think it's a blind leap to follow what God has for you. I think when we follow Him and He gets us out of our comfort zone into some other area, that we can trust in Him. And that's always been my biggest concern now, is not what God is calling me to do or asking me to do, but that I know it is God that's asking me to do that. Because I have no problem doing it if I know it is from God. Because I know He'll meet my needs or our needs. I know that He knows what we need, even when we don't. Because if we had not followed God, we'd probably still be in Taiwan doing missionary work. But that was not what God had planned us to continue doing. And you may have had a pastor here that had the church filled now. I don't know. You know, you may not even be here now. Who knows how things would change? It just reminds me of, I read something the other day. In our lifetime, see if you can wrap your mind around this. In your lifetime, whether you're an introvert, an extrovert, or somewhere in between, that you will influence 10,000 people. 10,000 people, they say, during a lifetime, you will influence. Is that just like mind-boggling? Mm-hmm. You know, it's like that butterfly effect. Everybody, you and then their friends, and then those friends, and then the other friends. So it just starts multiplying. Yeah, pretty amazing, huh? So how are you leading your life, and what are you doing to make that influence positive in other lives? Let us pray. Lord, we are just so thankful for this word today. Lord, we pray that you give us the words to pray. Lord, that we trust in you, that you know what's best for us. You know what we need, when we need it. And Lord, help us to make that our prayer and not what we need, or what we think we need, or what we want, but what you see us needing. Lord, you are our provider. Help us to trust in you to be our Lord and our Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, right now, we've got a special treat. We're going to have a special song done by Josie.
Yay! Couple things. I have lots of mustard seeds at home, so if nobody has a mustard seed, I've got plenty to share. Okay. That way you have a mustard seed and you know how to use it. When the pastor asked me to do a special and he told me it was going to be on this, of course the first song that came to my head was Peter and John went to, but that was wrong. That was totally wrong. That's what you get to. Oh, it's already on. But the kids' song is what first came to my mind.
You want me to move that out?
No.
You're okay.
I'm good. But anyway, I'm going to attempt to sign this song. And I think Harry's going to try and do some accompaniment voice. And this is, you may not physically get touched by God, by Jesus. But if you allow him to touch you spiritually, he'll lift your burden. Say is that God is looking at our heart. Speak those prayers as you're speaking to your best friend.
God knows what you need prayer for. And he wants that relationship with you. This is... I don't know. I think God just put this on my heart, you know, in these last few weeks, that maybe us praying together some of these things, that we're making a declaration. We're praying together as God's body. So let's all rise and let's repeat the words together. And if you don't like it, you can talk to the author. Oh, that was me. Okay. Oh Lord, help me in my lack of faith. Forgive me for not trusting in you and surrendering to your ways. I want you to be Lord in my life. Set me free from the worries and lies that keep me from your presence. Help me to know that your desire for me is to prosper and live an abundant life. You are my provider and you are my God. I will trust in you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Lord, we just lift this prayer up to you right now, that we do trust in you. Lord, help us to draw closer into your presence. Help us to develop a deeper love with you, Lord. Help us to experience your love. Help us to know your presence. And help us to walk in your ways. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.